This is a response to a lecture that Helen Caldicott gave in September of 2014. Helen Caldicott is a famous anti-nuclear activist who has dedicated her life to the worthwhile cause of preventing a nuclear war. In so doing, she also sets her sights on nuclear energy. It's important for there to be critical analysis of almost any industry, but it's just as important that that critique be factually accurate. Each side of the debate should strive to hone their argument to accurate perfection, and where they fall short, I'll do my best to help. And on that score, let's proceed to correct some major errors in Caldicott's speech.
This was released by the Australian Radiation Service on March the 11th and March 2000, and this was the potential fallout, which has actually come to pass. So here's Japan, and here are you. So within three, and this is the airborne radiation, and for the first 2 days, the wind was blowing from the west towards the east towards you, and the ambient levels of radiation in Seattle went up 40,000 times above normal. Did you know that? And if you didn't know, why didn't you know it? And if you weren't told by the government, why not? Because you elect the government to represent you and not the corporations. Huh?
The reason we never heard that radiation increased by 40,000 times on the West Coast is because it didn't. Nor was it ever predicted to. The fallout map that Caldicott is using was a joke. The website Snopes, famous for rooting out and reporting hoaxes, has a page on this map declaring that it is a hoax. The Australian Radiation Service expressly denies that they published the map. A reason why this is obviously a hoax is it says Western United States will receive 750 rads of radiation. However, it only takes between 250 and 400 rads to kill 50% of the people exposed. So this dose the West Coast was supposedly going to receive, and which Caldicott seems to think did receive, should have in fact killed most of the people on the West Coast. This hoax fallout map was spread around within hours of the disaster, and was debunked within a few days. And yet here it is, almost 4 years later, being reintroduced back into the public discourse, and by a prominent speaker. And yet Caldicott not only reintroduces this hoax, she adds a feature that serves to give it undue credence. Notice that she said this is the fallout that was predicted and that came to pass.
And this was the potential fallout, which has actually come to pass.
When this hoax map was released within hours of the disaster, it was presented as a prediction for fallout over the next 10 days. So if you fell for this hoax, that's the most that you could say, that this is what was predicted. And yet Caldicott adds that it was not only predicted, but it came to pass. In other words, it was confirmed. Yet that is something that she cannot possibly know, because it was never confirmed. It never happened. Mm-mm-mm.
What people don't know is that Tokyo got a very, very high fallout because it rained. And the highest level of fallout was detected in the Tokyo metropolitan area of Saitama, cesium radiation levels being detected at nearly a million becquerels per square meter. A becquerel is a disintegration per second of radiation, a level almost twice as high as the Chernobyl permanent dead zone evacuation limit of only 500,000 becquerels. Now, people want to go to Japan, they want to take their kids skiing, and you know, it's all fine. I just say, don't go to Japan. I've been there.
So cross Japan off your vacation list, because part of Tokyo is twice as radioactive as the Chernobyl exclusion limit. Good grief. Is that true? To assess this claim, I contacted members of SafeCast, a network of citizen radiation detectives mapping radioactivity across Japan. It turns out that the measurements that Caldicott cites came from a small group that is no longer active, and they used a wrong definition of the Chernobyl exclusion limit. The Chernobyl exclusion limit is based entirely on the radioactivity of cesium-137 alone. But as that group's report shows, they calculated radioactivity by combining both cesium-134 plus 137. But if we use the accurate definition of Chernobyl's exclusion limit, restricted to only cesium-137, then the same measures do not yield a level in excess of the Chernobyl exclusion limit. So Caldicott's claim is just not true. There's not part of Tokyo that's twice as radioactive as the Chernobyl exclusion zone. And the data she bases her claims on were rejected by the grassroots radiation detection community years ago. Of course, having fallout levels close to the Chernobyl exclusion limit would be reason for concern, but even that has not been demonstrated. As the experts at Safecast informed me, this sample was not demonstrated to be representative of the area. So while the efforts of the group that collected the sample may have been well-meaning, the bottom line is that the data Caldicott presented is junk.
I just say, don't go to Japan. I've been there 3 times. You don't know what you're eating. You don't know where the fish is sourced. You don't know if you're eating rice from Fukushima, which they're actively growing now. If it's very radioactive, they dilute it with non-radioactive rice. But the solution to pollution by dilution is fallacious when it comes to radiation because it reconcentrates back in your body. Okay?
That is one of the strangest things I hear among anti-nuclear activists, that you can't dilute nuclear fallout. It's an ultimately supernatural concept that induces an incredible amount of unnecessary fear, which is to say radiophobia. And Caldicott makes this claim boilerplate style, as we can see in this interview.
The solution to pollution by dilution is fallacious when it comes to radiation because, as I've explained, the food chain reconcentrates back the radioactive elements. But the solution to pollution by dilution is fallacious when it comes to radiation because it reconcentrates back in your body.
The argument that Caldicott would like to be true is that the process of bioaccumulation, which increases the concentration of pollutants inside versus outside an organism, is sufficient to reverse the dilution of radionuclides in the environment. So now let's acquaint ourselves with reality. These graphs show levels of fallout in the ocean around Fukushima, and they demonstrate that fallout in seawater around Fukushima has been progressively decreasing since 2011. In other words, the fallout is diluting, which is to say its parts per million are decreasing. These graphs in turn show the levels of fallout in fish in Japanese waters. These levels have also been decreasing since 2011. These two graphs are from a study just published. The graph on the left shows the decrease of fallout in seawater, and the graph on the right shows the decrease in fallout in fish, in both cases in Japanese waters. What these data show is that external dilution of fallout corresponds with a decrease in internal fallout. In other words, bioaccumulation is not reversing the effects of dilution. So Caldicott's claim is obviously falsified. Dilution does reduce the concentration of fallout in biological systems. This is all that I'm going to address in her lecture. It should be understood that these corrections are not meant to assert that therefore her overall argument against nuclear energy is wrong. But I have to say it's not exactly clear what her argument is other than what she believes to be a series of claims that are scary. Her argument structure seems something like scary fact 1, scary fact 2, scary fact 3, therefore no nukes. But I'm not so sure that qualifies as a sound argument, especially if some of those scary facts are in fact not facts. But that's certainly not to say that there aren't solid arguments against nuclear energy. It's just that she didn't strike me as making one of them.